The Point with Michael Williams.
Good morning and welcome. Coronavirus, the Florida, Palm Beaches, and Treasure Coast impact. That is our exclusive focus today, and we are streaming on all of our online platforms as well, WPTV.com, Facebook Live, and more. With us to talk, an infectious disease specialist who at the bottom of this hour will take your questions on Facebook Live. First, though, a familiar face, Republican Congressman Brian Mast. Thank you for being with us, representing the Treasure Coast and parts of northern Palm Beach County. You come back from the House, where the House has just passed a $40 billion plus emergency aid package. A national emergency has been declared. For our viewers in the Palm Beaches and Treasure Coast who are worried about what they're going to do for childcare, they're worried about small businesses, they're worried about layoffs, how am I going to make ends meet? Very specifically, talk about what the aid package intends to do for all of our viewers listening today who are worried about hard times ahead.
Sure. So some of the biggest top lines, right? Number one, about $1.2 billion for increased testing divvied out amongst all of the states. Go down to what we're talking about for individuals that are working, worrying about their kids, you know, possibly staying home from school, you name it. So there's provisions in there for paid family sick leave. These are paid for, and not just that, but family leave as well, whether you have to take care of somebody or whether you yourself might be suffering from symptoms, you don't want to go out there, or you test positive for this. What those provisions include are if you're helping somebody that's a member of your family, up to $200 a day and change to assist you, or up to $500 a day, up to if those are your wages in terms of individual leave. Now, employers might be asking themselves, how do I pay for that? I can't go out there and just pay for somebody to not be working that way. The way that this occurs is through every employer and employee pays what's known as the payroll tax. Mm-hmm. So through the payroll tax, which is 6.2% for the employer, they will get a credit towards that for any dollar that is spent towards putting somebody on that kind of leave, a direct credit towards that, so that that's not a cost that they have to bear directly out of their pocket.
So again, 2 weeks of paid sick leave, up to 3 months of family and medical leave if you need it. And again, you talked about the tax credits for small and medium-sized businesses. For those watching who say, how do I cut through the red tape and get access to that money, which I may need more rapidly? All of us, I'm sure you are. I certainly am hearing from people already in danger of losing jobs in the service economy that so much buttresses our tourism economy. How do we cut the red tape, and how quickly will people be able to easily access that kind of help and get that money in their pockets?
The goal? As quick as possible, right? Obviously, this is something that's going to be going through the Senate on Monday. I was in Washington, D.C. We passed that bill through the House of Representatives on Saturday morning, about 12:30 in the morning. Senate has yet to pass this. It will go to the president's desk immediately, and will immediately, as the president signs it, which will probably sometime Monday afternoon, will be divvied out and start heading down towards the states, not just in terms of those programs that we just spoke about, but also in terms of additional resources for Medicaid, for programs like women's, infants, and children, SNAP programs, you know, children's health insurance program, all these programs. There are provisions in there as well.
Again, though, people will wonder when the money starts flowing. Red tape, of course, is the bane of reacting quickly in a crisis.
Bureaucracy.
Where will people say, I can easily go? Where will your office, for instance, say, okay, if you need the sick leave, if you're an employer looking for the tax credits because you're having to let people off and you need to keep your business running, where specifically will they go? What infrastructure will be set up that will make that as seamless as possible and as fast as possible?
So number one, let me just start with my office. Sure. And say my offices remain open for any people that have appointments with us or want to speak to us or have an appointment. We offer a number of different options, as we always do. If you still feel that there's absolutely a need to meet with me in person, we'll still meet with you in person, but there's always an option to Skype with me, to get on a phone call with me or from somebody from my office, whether it's in Washington, D.C. or down here in Florida. All of those resources will still be out there. So for employers that need help dealing with that bureaucracy with the IRS or with somebody else, reach out to us. Let us know how we can assist, what we need to explain to you in terms of payroll tax credit, working through the IRS on that front. But that is directly where the employer doesn't have to reach out for a dollar to say, this is where it's going to go. It's going to come through the payroll tax credit and being offset in that way. So what they would normally have to pay for tax, they now will not have to pay for tax. It will go towards this.
What are we looking at in terms of extended unemployment benefits?
So in terms of unemployment benefits for individuals, you're not going to have to go out there and show that proof for some of those programs where you normally have to show where you are employed. You no longer have to go out there and show those proofs during this virus for those programs like WIC or SNAP, some of those other other programs that I mentioned. You don't have to make those proofs
help with
of,
food benefits.
Exactly, for those food benefit programs.
Congressman, you've been getting briefings all along. How bad is this going to get?
So I can't give you the prediction of exactly where it goes to. I can
and
give
I'm
you numbers.
I'm talking both health-wise, and we'll have an infectious disease specialist, and we're on right now, and we'll be taking questions with him on Facebook Live at the bottom of the hour, I want to reiterate. But first, let's take it from the health component, your sense, and we'll talk to him about that, but also the economic component of people saying, how long? How long are we going to deal with this and hunker down or have to like this with the economic cost as well? First, the health side.
Best I can give you from my sense based upon conversations with CDC or state surgeon general or emergency management individuals, right? Important to point out, this is not smallpox. This is not Ebola. It's absolutely worse than the flu, but it's not those things. So when we talk about this, we all need to be doing the same things, whether we've been tested or not, not having those congregations with individuals, not making sure that we have better levels of hygiene, restaurants are holding themselves or hotels or any place like that, holding themselves to the highest possible standard. But let me put something in terms of numbers for you, right? I think one of the best things to point at is the numbers of mild versus serious cases worldwide. Now, bear in mind, I'm not going to tell you that I believe every case is reported. Not everybody has been tested. We can talk about some of those things. But based upon the numbers that I have, in the U.S. right now, 2,930 cases nationwide. Of those, 2,920 are considered to be mild. What does that mean? It means they're not behind a plastic tarp. They're not in ICU. They're not on a respirator. They're individuals that are self-quarantined in their home with maybe worse than flu-like symptoms, diarrhea, shortness of breath, certainly different, but other things going on like that. There's a very small percentage that are quarantined in an ICU that are facing very dire circumstances right now. That's a difference.
Yeah, of course, we worry about the elderly. I have elderly parents.
And my father's 90.
My dad will be 89 soon. My mom's 85, so certainly it comes home to us as well. We do know that most are mild or moderate cases, and yet worst case scenarios say perhaps worst case up to, I've heard reports of, you could see up to 1 million, everything from 1 million deaths to something lower than that. Numbers are all over the place, but all of this comes back to a central question about how could we have bollocked the testing rollout, and there's been severe criticism about the rollout of testing. And to this day, most people don't know how they could call their doctor and easily get a test. When we hear 15,000 tests a day being done in a place like South Korea in drive-by fashion and state by state here, it seems a very decentralized, very haphazard response on testing. Why have we failed on that?
So I think, number one, let's talk about the genesis of this, right? Started sometime in December in China. They made every effort to keep it away from the eyes of the world and their own people. That's how it advanced to 80,000 people within China alone in the case of about a month. The U.S. wasn't really able to go out and start addressing this until early January. World Health Organization finally identifies it as pneumonia-like symptoms. Beginning of February, President says people aren't going to travel in from
but
China.
The CDC
move forward,
the
right?
First batch of tests, for instance, that had to be redone.
Get to that testing, right? Right now, testing in the state of Florida, up to 300 a day, maybe closer to 500 with LabCorp doing their tests as well, but Florida Department of Health, up to 300 a day. That's going to advance by next week to about 5,000 a day capability in the state of Florida. State of Florida purchased about 625,000 tests. So why can somebody get tested? Then that's important to say how many have tested when you ask,
sure,
why such a low number? So it's not as though anybody's going to go into their doctor and say, I just have anxiety, I'm worried, can you get me a test? The answer is probably going to begin to be no. They're going to say, okay, do you have a fever? Or do you have shortness of breath? Or do you have any of these other flu-like symptoms? If not, they're probably not going to identify you. Have you come in contact with somebody that is a known carrier? Have you been traveling to one of these countries? You're going to have to meet that profile to get tested. And that's where you see those numbers of who has been tested.
And we will look at that in containment. The bottom line is, though, we don't know, and briefly here, as we want to get our infectious disease specialist in, we don't know how long we're going to be looking at the economic fallout or the health fallout here. We just don't know.
Of course not. With supply chains, with non-travel, it's important that we don't have that. We're limiting that travel, but yes, unknown effects into the future, no question.
And we, in our next segment, I was going to do it here, but we'll put up the number of cases in Florida in our next segment and symptoms. Do have to ask, there is the political component. The president being praised by some, being criticized by many others for lack of leadership. One quote, he's repeatedly made statements about efforts to combat the virus that are wrong, said one editorial writer. Even as testing was severely limited, he said, anyone who wants a test can get one. hasn't been true. He just suggested the country was very close to a vaccine, despite evidence that health experts say it's a year away. He said he'd closed travel from Europe the other night, even though Americans and legal residents were exempted, and that caused a hiccup for a while in the markets. Some are arguing that the president did not take it seriously enough, early enough. And to those who say you're making it political, in 2013, this was a president who said of Barack Obama, when you're in leadership, it's on you.
Yeah, when you're, has you're a leader, you failed, lead, no
has,
question.
Has he failed in some aspects in his leadership?
Look, I think there's been hiccups in messaging, no doubt. But let me talk to the policy and where it's totally different from where it would have otherwise gone. And I don't want to have a hyper-political conversation, absolutely, but I have to frame this in terms of Pelosi Schumer versus President Trump, right? So he cut off travel from China. The immediate response from them was, this is xenophobic, you can't do that. The biggest worry was, how are people from China going to feel about being profiled in this way? Not, man, you're doing a good thing for the citizens of the United States of America, considering this is the origin, the ground zero for this. That wasn't the consideration. It was a total making sure that they're politically correct response instead of, let's just do what's best for the American people. So when you're asking, do I think that the president has been strong enough on it? I think absolutely yes. I think he's been far stronger than what we would see from whether it was Pelosi or Schumer managing this situation. Could some things have gone smoother? Absolutely yes. Do I think this is an important learning lesson as we go through this for what happens when you cut off travel from nations or from an entire continent, or when you have to ramp up testing for something that has never been seen before in this kind of way? For our emergency managers, moving forward, very important. I think you'll be able to see a lot of after action review on this. But no, I think that the president has done things that would be unseen by anybody else.
Obviously, the Democratic response would be a different to that. But as you said, right now, the first and foremost concerns about health and the bottom line is that people can get in touch with offices like yours if they have questions about cutting the red tape to get the kind of aid that so many people are going to need in the weeks and months to come.
They 100% should. We'll still be in our office. Reach out. They want to speak to me directly or anybody else in my staff. We'll help them every step along the way.
I'd shake hands, but I guess we want to show good protocol. Congressman Brian Mast, we'll have you back. Thank you for giving some perspective. We appreciate it. And coming up, the latest on the coronavirus, its impact, and our infectious disease specialist next.